Hello to you, friends. This is Stammer on air, but first, a daily, early Buddhist contemplation. As long as this life lasts, I hereby take refuge in the Buddha. I hereby take refuge in the Dhamma. I hereby take refuge in the Sangha. I hereby seek shelter in the Buddha for the second time. I hereby seek shelter in the Dhamma for the second time. I hereby seek shelter in the Sangha for the second time. I hereby request protection from the Buddha for the third time. I hereby request protection from the Dhamma for the third time. I hereby request protection from the Sangha for the third time. The three refuges is hereby taken. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all killing. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all stealing. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all sexual abuse. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all dishonesty. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all alcohol and drugs, as long as this life lasts. From now on, I can hereby rightly consider myself to be a true Buddhist with the blessed Buddha as my teacher. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 56, recorded on the 3rd February 2017 in the backdrop of Herbis Cypress Hermitage on a sunny day, but also a little windy. There are one simile, three questions, and one karma story. But first, the normal intro, as usual. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened is the blessed Buddha. So, we take the simile first. It's called the simile of the Sabbath tree, and it's from Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here, book 35 on the sixth census, number 231. So, the Buddha said, if one is not free of greed, hate, and ignorance, of attraction, repulsion, and delusion, then any trifling object, any trifling form that comes into the visual field, then the mind is obsessed by that. So, what then to talk about any major object, major form, dominant form, then mind also is obsessed. And it says it's like so also with the other six senses. Whatever sound, whatever smell, whatever taste, whatever touch, and whatever mental state, idea and phenomena that comes into the field of these senses, then if this mind is still under influence of greed, hate, and ignorance, then it's either attracted or repulsed or blinded, deluded by the contact with the given object. So he said, it's like a sabbat tree. There's many of those here around. And if you go out with an axe and start chopping in a sabbat tree, then the sap comes out. So also he said, it is with this mind that is under influence of the mental fermentations, the asava, which brew up assumptions, which brew up the assumption that whatever form, whatever object comes into the sense experience field of the mind, then it is pleasure, it is happiness, it is lasting, and it is self, it can't be me, it can't be mine. So this fermentation of sensuality, kamasava, is a consequence of greed, hate and delusion. It's a consequence of a non-enlightened mind. Only at the enlightenment is this kamasava, this fermentation of sensuality, of being able to sense something, this is eradicated. So we said also, with a mind that is not under influence of greed, hate and ignorance, whatever sense object it comes into touch with, whether a dominant sense object or a trifling sense object, whatever forms it sees, whatever sounds it hears, whatever taste, smell, touch or mental state it contacts, then this mental influence flow out like the sap of the tree of attraction, repulsion and delusion. This doesn't occur. And that's why we say the arahat, he's dry. He's dry like an alcoholic, he's not addicted anymore by these obsessions connected with sensing. He's not dry in the sense that he's barren, he's very fruitful, on the contrary, because he's full of happiness and peace and release. But he's not flowing out with attraction caused by greed, repulsion caused by hate or aversion, or delusion caused by ignorance. He's not. So he's like a desiccated, dried out tree that doesn't flow out with any sap. Why is there no sap from the arahant? It's because he's abandoned and cleared himself completely, completely of all greed, all hate, and all ignorance. Therefore, when whatever object he contacts, whether significant or prominent object, like sexual forms, sexual organs, whatever he attracted to, cars or houses or money or power, fame and name, then there is, because of this lack of this greed, this attraction doesn't flow out the mind. This repulsion doesn't flow out the mind. This delusion doesn't cover over the mind, because he's gone dry, just like the dried out, desiccated tree. These fermentations, asava, they can be, there are three of them actually. There's the fermentation of sensuality, which is most easy to see. It is the assumption that whatever objects one sees that is attractive, delightful, alluring, then one thinks, there's lasting happiness there. Though the happiness is not to be found in the object itself. It cannot be seen in the object itself. So it's a fermentation in the sense it's a brewing up of something that is not there. Just like when you put sugar and water together, and there's also a little yeast, and then there's heat, then this ferment, so there comes alcohol, appears down in this soup. Alcohol was not there before, but it comes into being because of this fermentation process. So minds fermentates sensuality, any sense object, and mistakes it to be either pleasure or pain. There's also a fermentation of views, and there's a fermentation of becoming. And these three fermentations are what the arahat is free from. So he doesn't ferment anything. He doesn't put anything into the data or into the situation that is not there in advance. He doesn't assume anything. He doesn't suppose anything. He doesn't ferment anything. So much for the Sabbath tree. Again, from the Connected Discourses, Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here, which is highly recommendable. It covers a whole range of subjects, and they are usually connected in the sense that one chapter of each subject. And now we have spoken several times now about the six senses, about the dangers of these six senses. And this is from the Sarayatana Samyutta, the Samyutta number, chapter number 35. Question number 180. Science says that it can be theoretically possible to go back in time through wormholes. From a Buddhist perspective, is this possible? And if so, what would be the implication on it on karma? Science doesn't say that it's possible to go back in time. Science says that there might be a possibility to go back in time. Two ways. Quantum mechanics says there can be a bending of space-time, so there's a wormhole, kind of like a tunnel back in time. And relativity says if you go faster than time, then time starts faster than light in speed, then time starts go backwards. So these are the two options that contemporary physics seems to open up. But then there is a famous grandfather paradox, which rips the carpet away under both of them. And it was suggested by a French journalist, critic, and science fiction writer, René Bajavel, which you see here and here. Nice gentleman, he died in 1985. And he wrote science fiction movies, and he suggested this grandfather paradox. If one could go back in time, then one could go back to one's grandfather's time and then kill him. Then one of one's parents would not be born. This means oneself would not be born. But if oneself was not be born, how could one go back and kill the grandfather? So there's a logical breakdown there in this circle. If you really could do that, and that obviously you could do that if you could to travel back in time, then causality will break down. So this has been this grandfather paradox has been a mainstay both in philosophy and physics, since Bajavel suggested it in one of his science fiction novels. And this seems to indicate that this is not possible from a causality point of view. Buddha have not spoken directly about it, but he said that a noble disciple doesn't confuse the past with the present or the present with the future. And he not said anything else than that. And personally, I think that this kind of nails it, because if this is possible, then you should say, but then there's some actions that you cannot do if you go back in time. And this seems very unnatural. If one should be able to go back in time, then all options should be open. But this option that you kill your grandfather or grandmother or both, this seems to exclude that this is possible, because it's a logical breakdown of causality. However, it is worth noticing that whether you can go backwards in time or forwards in time or go to another planet or another universe or transcend it altogether, then it would not clear the problem of suffering, the problem of dissatisfaction, of frustration, of impermanence. It would not clear that problem. Wherever you appear from this jumping in time, the situation will be the same. So it's not, in my opinion, really worth following after these very speculative and fantastic theories about this and that, and whether this or that is possible or not. It is not advantageous, and it's not connected with the goal. It's not connected with approaching Nirvana, approaching lasting happiness, approaching peace. It is connected with spin up of mental junk that ends nowhere. So I think we should thank Mr. René Bajavel for this grandfather paradox, which nails that coffin, probably once and for all. I'll give two links to the grandfather paradox. That's a nice, small, 1 minute YouTube about it, and comes right here. And there's one link to René Bajavel also on Wikipedia, and the grandfather paradox comes also right here. And it's also under the video. Question 181. Please explain why our bad karma is erased if we ask the affected person for forgiveness. What is the logic and reason behind it? Yes, the answer is karma is, what is karma? It's a form of radiation, because it's embedded in a wave phenomena. Just like the light that is hitting me now from the sun, it goes through the shadow of a tree. You can see I have a spotted shadows. So some place the light goes off because it's reflected by the tree, and then it causes shadows here and there. And other places it's not reflected and it hits me. So this radiation, in this case coming from the sun, is the karmic radiation is a bit difficult. Another kind, it's also a wave phenomenon that has a frequency. It's also a field that's just like a field of light or a field of gravity. It is everywhere present. So it doesn't shine from any particular angle like this light. So it's a more complex kind of light. It's like diffused light that comes through the clouds. It seems to be coming from everywhere with a low intensity. So also it's a karmic radiation. It is not visible, but it's immeasurable, and it's an orthogonal component or inherent component of all consciousness that contains intention. So actually it follows the same rules as light on the macroscopic scale, that is reflected by some surfaces. And as you see in these pictures as follows, these reflections depend very much on the geometry of the surface. So if it's a concave surface, then it concentrates the light. If it's a convex surface, then it spreads the light. If it's a plane mirror, then it's just reflect the incoming angle is equal to the outgoing angle of the light. But that can the karmic mirror effect is very complex, because the mirror in this case is another being, and also another world, a future world actually. So in the case one, ask for forgiveness towards a person who has been hurt by one's action, one's speech, or one's thinking, or one's doings, then it's like the mirror is taken away. Because the mirror effect is that pain that this person has been experiencing or will experience. And when this mirror is taken away, then the reflected probability that is coming back from this reflection process, this is taken away. So it can be likened to that you have a situation where you have light going in a mirror and coming back. Then here you have also a form of radiation. It's also a wave phenomena, but it's the wave height, the amplitude of the wave is the square of the of the probability. So the square of the amplitude is the probability. Nevertheless, if there is another person that has been hurt, then it will reflect. If this person forgives, it's like there's no reflection. So there's no echo. So this means that the probability doesn't come back to the source from wherever it was sent out. Doesn't come back. And that's the reason, basically. It's a consequence of wave mechanics, and a consequence of mirror effects of either absorption or reflection. The person that sends back the intended wave, this wave then get absorbed in the one that sent it out. Just like the light gets absorbed by the tree that's standing in front of me and takes most of the sunlight. It absorbs the light. So also the karmic wave that coming here, made out of probability, it's absorbed by the person who have sent it out. he will then experience, or she will experience, the events connected with this karmic response. And this is a highly context dependent, because it's two probability distribution that are overlaid. There's a probability distribution of the person, what is possible for the person. Then there's a probability distribution from the physical world, what is possible in that particular time and space coordinate, what is possible from the physical world. Then these two probability distribution are overlaid. And then there comes this wave of karmic. This is in, wave in between. And whatever is, this will interfere, there will come a resulting wave probability distribution out of it. And the highest top in this wave probability distribution will be the event that falls out. Whether this person will fall and break the leg, or whether this person will win $1,000 in a lottery, whether this person will smile or feel sad, or so on. All these events, observations, are determined by probability. And this probability is partially determined in advance. In this case, there is, has been an echo from a hurt person, there has been a, this person has unintentionally, by hurting the other person, put up a mirror that reflects his own probabilities back to himself. In this case, evil ones, or bad ones, wrong ones, which are connected with feeling pain here at this point. Because this was, that was, the person who was hurt also felt pain. So pain out, pain back. Pleasure out, pleasure back. So it's a completely, in a complete analogy to any kind of reflected process. Also an echo, if you yell out in a valley, then there come an echo back with the same frequency that you yell out, and it will come back several times. According to the geometry of the valley, there will come several echoes back. And so also with the echoes of probability, they can come back in this life, in the next life, or in subsequent lives. In the Kama story, we will hear about some echoes that are coming back from another universe, several universes back. Still, these echoes are, because they are everywhere present, and they are not dampened by anything. They don't run out. They're not caused by anything else than the person who has sent them out themselves, because it's frequency specific. This means that the only absorber there is in a given universe for a given person's karma, this is the karma, the person himself or herself. It's the only one that can absorb and thereby eradicate that energy, that probability that is in that in this wave phenomena. So there's one emitter that sends out karma, and one absorber that absorbs the karma again. Because of the frequency specificity of consciousness, and thereby also of intention, and thereby also of karma. Because karma is intention, chetana, said the Buddha. I hope this explains it clearly. If you get forgiveness, then the mirror disappears. Then there's no reflection. The wave is gone, basically. Minutes in. Question 182. Was the three Lord Buddhas, past Lord Buddhas, born on this earth, considering the dinosaur era with humans only 200 million years ago? Yes, the dinosaurs lived 200, 300 million years ago, and humans became after that. And what is the distance from our Buddha Siddhartha Gautama to Buddha Kassapa? 576 million years. How do we know that? Because this is the life length in the Tusita heaven where the Buddhas, they reside before they come down here. And they all live a full life length. This means that it can be the minimum age between two Buddhas is 576 million years. This means that this must be before the Kassapa Buddha must be before the dinosaurs. And this means that the evolution probably have run more than one time. There will be no fossils left because the fossil record is extremely incomplete. But even for, if you say 200 million years, there's almost nothing left. Precambrian period, which is 500, 700 million years, there's almost nothing left. So we see no fossil records from that time. So three Buddhas will be something like 2 billion years. But the Earth is 5 billion years. So there's plenty of space for evolution to run more than one time in the period of 5 billion years. This is, as we say, if this estimate is true. The estimate of the Earth being 5 billion years and the universe being 13.7 billion years is from the 50s, where radioactive dating was done on fragments from the Canyon Diablo iron meteorite, which you see here, which fell down in a crater, in which you see also here, down in Arizona. And then the person who was interested in lead and lead, radioactive lead isotopes, he measured the different lead isotopes in that and could then determine the age. However, this is based on an assumption that time goes the same speed through all universal time. And that's all radioactive and also carbon dating, but especially the long-range dating based on radioactive data, they have this mistake that is not really repairable, because time is expanding, space is expanding, and then this causes time dilation. Why is that so? Because of Einstein, basically, special relativity. Any observer that looks on a reference frame that is moving according to him, then if he measures, there's a clock in that reference frame, for example, a pendulum that swings back and forth one time per second, and he has a digital watch one time per second. If it moves according to him, then he will measure that it moves slower than his watch go. While one who's moving along with the watch, with the old pendulum watch, he can see it's exactly accurate with his digital watch. So this means that time goes slower if two things are moving compared to each other. The situation which first comes 40 years after this carbon dating, or this lead dating of Earth age, is that the universe's expansion is accelerating, as you see here. And it's accelerating very fast. This means that everything, basically everything, comes longer and longer from each other with an increasing speed. This means, just like in special relativity and Einstein, that is moving reference frames according to whatever observer point you have. And this means that there's time dilation. This means basically that time goes slower. And this can then, this radioactive dating that is based on that there's a constant time from the birth of the universe to the end of the universe, then this falls down. Then this aging have to be regulated very much up. And this has been the situation. Actually, at Darwin's time, one thought in the 1890s, one thought that Earth was 200 million years old. Then Darwin said, no, it cannot be possible, because then the biological evolution cannot take place so fast. And then one thought, in the 1920s, one thought it was 1.5 billion years old. And then in 30 years later, in 1956, then it was suddenly 5.6 billion years old. And when we have learned to do relativistic dating from radioactive data, then it will be much longer, probably. Now I think it's not really possible, because it will entail that you have to know how fast time goes and each time slice of the universal ages. And this, we have no access to this kind of data yet. So we don't know how fast time goes from the birth of the universe to now. So the speed of time is not constant during that interval. And that's where the mistake comes in. So Earth could be potentially much older than these 5.6 billion years. Buddhism says that approximately one universal cycle, one eon, one kalpa, is in the order of 150 billion years. And that is, we say, from Big Bang until it stands still and starts contracting again,
That should be to next Big Bang is 150 billion years. This means that one half cycle is 75 billion years. And so we should be only now only 5 billion years in. It seems a little bit small compared to 75 billion years for half the universal cycle. We should go into a cold death, because the universe becomes very cold when everything expands from each other. This distance just grow bigger and bigger. It's called the cold death if we just keep going on. Nobody, we will be able to see no stars, no other planets, and so on. So there's no radiation, no light. Therefore, it's called cold death. So, seen from that perspective, then 5 billion years seems on the short side. I would say 20 billion years is more look more reasonable compared to 75 billion years for a half cycle. And if you talk 20 billion years five Buddha cycles only take 2.5 billion years, then there's plenty of time for more than one evolution to run on planet Earth, and we wouldn't see. All the crust of the surface of the Earth is remodeled, so mountains disappear and oceans disappear, and the whole thing is remodeled over so large timescales. So there is no fossil record left. This said that the universe is expanding very much, as it's accelerating, also came as a surprise. This is only from the 1990s and was discovered with using telescopes that could see very far supernovae, and then measure their redshift and then see that they were speeding out much faster than we thought originally. So there's many assumptions in science today that has to be revised based on relativity and based on quantum mechanics. I said it before, I think the aging problem from this radioactive data is wrong. It's based on an assumption of constant time. And this thing we know, constant time, doesn't exist because of special relativity. There's no universal absolute time anywhere. There's nothing that causes simultaneity. If there's two observers, they keep look at the same event and they are moving about, then they will cannot agree upon which time it happened. So there's no, we have this idea that there is the same time all over the universe. This is not the case. It's observer dependent. And it's here Buddha really shines again, because he puts the observer into the equation and say, but when you speak about the world, you're speaking about the mind and its object. And this also relativity says, if the observer moves according to what he observes, then he affects the time in what he observes. It starts going slower. So there's time dilation and length contraction. So a train that's passing in front of an observer with close to the speed of light, and the time will go very slow in that time, and it'll be a very short train. This is for real. This is for real. Why I say it with radioactive method is because one have made experiments with it. When I take radioactive molecules and put them inside an accelerator, it's a vacuum tube that is going around, and they are charged the particles, then one can accelerate them up to something like 10-20% of the speed of light. And radioactive particles, they have a half-life when their radioactivity goes down to 50%. It's exactly halved. And this half-life is constant for the given particle, whether it's uran or can be whatever. For technetium, for example, it's a couple of hours. For uran, I think it's 200,000 years. So this half-life can be very different. But if you can take something that is, let's say, half-life on 1 day, 24 hours or 2 hours, then you see if you put it into an accelerator and accelerate it up so that this is moving very fast according to you, which is observer, then the half-life of the particles, when you look at your radioactive counter outside the accelerator, then the half-life goes up. So it experiences this radioactive particle, which is not a conscious being. This experiences time goes slower. There's time dilation. And this time dilation also goes for the lead particles in this meteorite Diablo meteorite that fell down and was used for dating the Earth. I also find it funny that one uses a meteorite to date the Earth. It's a meteorite for, they say, from the solar system, but who knows where it came from, actually? Nobody knows. But it should say that then the solar system was formed approximately at that time. But I would say it's more logic to take some rock on planet Earth and then analyze that. But that, of course, can be reformed by volcanic and melted and reformed again. And then this also will havoc the dating. So it's not a trivial issue. But nevertheless, even if we assume that this Diablo meteorite, of which the largest one is 600 kilos, which you see here also, if it is from the solar system and has something to do with Earth aging, then still it is a non-relativistic calculation based on the assumption that time is constant over the entire span of the universal age. And that we know is not true because there's extreme space expansion. And this will cause time dilation because everything is moving relative to anything else in an expanding space. So there's plenty of space for five Buddhas, but not more than that, says the text. Even if the age of the Earth is 5.6 billion years, that is 5.6 thousand million years. Then we go to the Kama story, which is an interesting thing. This is about the Dapa Malaputta, Dapa the Malian. He was from a race, or you can say a tribe called the Malians. And he was called Dapa because his mother died on his birth, and then he was found with close to her funeral fire. And this firewood you use for funeral pyre, this is called Dapa. So he's called Dapa the Malian. He was enlightened when they shaved his hair as an only 7 year young boy. He asked for enlightenment to go forth from his grandmother because his mother was died. And then when he shaved him, then he became enlightened by seeing his hair fall to the ground and then reflect on impermanence just once. Clack. Then the phase transition of consciousness went into action and he became enlightened right there. So he has nothing more to do. Why he became enlightened so early? It's said that under Buddha Kassapa, then he together with five others, he was as a monk, and then he was frustrated that he could not gain enlightenment. Then they found a rock, kind of like a plateau rock, that was more than 20 meters from top, and it has vertical rock face, couldn't climb up and down. Then they constructed a ladder, then they went up there, all six of them, stayed up there and then throw away the ladder. So they couldn't come down. So it was do or die. They were very determined. We go up there on this rock, all of us, and then we either enlightened or we die. So very forceful determination. Then it so happened that two of them enlightened. Then these two could fly through the air. And then they began, said to the other, we can come back and give you food. We can go Pindabat because we can fly through the air. Then the five guys say, no, we won't have it. And among them was Dapa the Malaputta Thera that died on that. And this was the cause that he was so close, he was so determined on enlightenment. This was the cause that next time, this means that he was very close to the threshold. He needed only a hair's breadth. So when he was born under Siddhartha Gautama, they not just need to shave a few hair locks off them, let them fall to the ground, and then he will see upon and reflect upon impermanence, and this will release him from attachment to this body. This was one kind of karma. This was a good karma in this case. Another event happened later on, he then asked, what should I do? He asked the Buddha. And then the Buddha said, you can be a pointer of lodgings and a pointer of food tickets. A pointer of lodgings is to say, if somebody comes to the monastery, then Dabara Mariputta, he will show them their Bhavanakuti, their meditation hut out in the forest. And he did that with a trick. When they came late at night, then he used his thumb as a light. He then come light up, fire out his thumb. So he walked around in the forest with a flame up from his thumb. And this trick became so well known. So the monks that came to Jetavana Monastery, they delayed their arrival to after dark, so they could see Dabada Maliputta turn on his thumb lamp, where flames came up. Actually, one slave girl called Punya, she was so impressed with this trick that she, just by seeing it, she became a stream entrant. So in this case, this slave woman actually, a slave girl, actually became a stream entrant just from seeing Maliputta light up his thumb, I think, at one time. However, Dabada Maliputta also did something wrong under Buddha Vipassi. Then he had accused an arahat of being non-celibate, wrongly. And this then bounced back as a reflection much later, many universal cycles later, when Buddha Siddhartha came, and he himself should be enlightened. Then this dhamma, this karma fell out. How did it fell out? Yeah, actually, first there was an event where he should give food tickets to five naughty monks. One of them was Mithiya Bhumajagga. And then he gave food tickets to them. They should go to a rich man. And then the rich man, he heard that these are the five naughty monks coming. So usually he will give out very good food and serve them himself from his own hand, but he didn't do. He put his slave to serve the monks. And this Mithiya Bhumajagga, he then thought that Dabba the Malian, he has slandered them by telling something to the rich man. So he made a scheme. He had a nun who was his friend, and then he told her to go to the Buddha and accuse Dabba the Malian of having seduced her. So Dabba the Malian, he got the same wrong accusation that he had done towards others, he got back himself. However, it was then examined, and it was proven wrong, and this Mithiya nun, she was disbelled, she was disrobed by the Buddha, thrown out the Sangha. But nevertheless, this Mithiya Bhumajagga monk, he was not satisfied still. So he had a supporter, a rich man, and he convinced him to go to the Buddha and make the same accusation one more time that Dabada Madan had seduced his wife. This was also examined and proven wrong. And so Buddha, he reinstated Dabada Malian in his position. Then the monks, hearing about this rich man, which deliberately had told a lie to the Buddha to taint Dabada Malian, they turned down his bound the bowl. This just means that they refused to take any food from this particular rich man, which has accused Dabada Malian of seducing his wife falsely. They wouldn't take any, accept anything from him. And this is the strongest political statement Buddhists can do, and Buddhist monks can do. They also did that in Burma towards the military, when there was a military junta there. That is to turn the bowl upside down, we say. You refuse to take anything from people who have done something very evil. And why is that? Then you close down, you cut their source to karma. They cannot get any good karma from the Sangha. And then they will experience the effect of their bad karma because they cannot compensate their good karma by putting something in the bowl. So it's very effective. And then they said, we will not receive anything from you before you have admitted that you lied deliberately to the Buddha. And this he did. He did. He admitted that he lied under wrong influence from his monk friend, the evil monk, Mithiya Bhumajagga. And then he asked for forgiveness and got forgiveness. A third time, he also was Laludai, another bad monk at the Buddhist time. There was five bad monks. You see, he was one of these guys. Laludai, he was kind of like simple-minded, a little stupid. So he accused Dabbadamalian and Arahat of not doing his job properly, of this assigning the Bhavanakutis, the meditation hut. And then Laludai got the job, but then he did it wrongly. So Dabbadamalian, he got it back. But it's just to show that if you accuse something wrong about wrongly, accuse something, somebody about doing something that they didn't do, then it'll come back to you. And in Dabbadamalian's case, it came back more than one time, in more than one life, but very forcefully in his last life, where he two times wrongly was accused of having seduced a woman and had sex with him when he hadn't touched him at all. In his former lives in under Padmacura Buddha, he had wished to be, he was a millionaire's son and offered to the Buddha, and then he has wished to be the one foremost in assigning meditation huts to others. And this then he became in his last life. Furthermore, as giving to this Padmacura Buddha as a millionaire's son, he became, 103 times he became king of the Tamahibsa heaven, and 105 times he became king among humans. And then there was this time under Vipassana Buddha where he spoke evil about another monk, which is what is an arahant, that he was non-celibate. And this caused all these echoes of wrong accusations later down the road. But the story ended good, because under Kassapa Buddha, he decided now it was the time to enlightenment. He climbed the hill together with six others. Two of them enlightened, not Dabbadamalian. They throw away the ladder. He died up there, and then he came back and became enlightened under Siddhartha Gautama at the age of 7 years. There was three guys, three boys at the Buddhist time that enlightened at the age of seven. And in all cases, the Buddha said to the elderly monks, 50 or 60 years, don't clap them on, pat them on the head, because their bodies are young, but their minds are the oldest in the universe. So even though they are 7 years old, they are your senior. And this gives sense to something else. And he said, be careful, you don't know who's who. So these young guys, three young, seven-year-old boys, they were arahants. They were the oldest one in the universe, the most matured one in minds. And even today, we have to learn one of the 10 questions the Buddha, he asked a boy. The 10 questions to the boy, we have to memorize these, because this boy was an arahant. And this we can take next time, the 10 questions to the boy. This concludes Dhamma on Air, number 56. Thank you for your patience, for your contribution, for your understanding, and for your participation. May you have a nice day. Remember to click subscribe down there. If you want to support, or you want to have more information, hover over this region with your mouse. And there's a small eye, white eye. Click the small eye, then there's five links coming down for you right there. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cyprus Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.
As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and help a nice day.